إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلق من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار We praise Allah, we glorify Him, we seek His help in all our affairs. We ask Allah to give us gratitude, thankfulness, because when we stop and think about the number of people who are still unguided and who are roaming around astray, perhaps some of them are looking for directions in life, many of them are not. We feel obliged to respect the fact that Allah, to His wisdom and kindness, chose you and me to be Muslims. So we ask Allah to make us grateful, thankful, so that we fulfill our duties to Him and we show good manners to His creation according to the principles of Islam. Whomsoever Allah guides, nobody can mislead, and those whom He leaves to stray, none can find for guidance. I do bear witness that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, and I also testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's final messenger to the whole of mankind and the jinn. Today I'm going to talk about relief after difficulty, which I had discussed perhaps a year ago in this place and several weeks ago at the city circle. So if it's a repeat for some brothers and sisters, I do apologize, but perhaps it's going to be a good reminder for all of us anyway, inshallah. I want to talk about this subject because the Muslims are indeed going through a lot of problems in general. We all have our own individual problems, whether it's family problem or you're not getting on with a friend or exams around the corner, we haven't studied well enough. We have all personal difficulties and problems. But we look at our nation in general and we see how they're undergoing severe trials and tribulations all across the world. And we find ourselves at the helm of a situation where only we can provide the solution. We have the tools, we have, inshallah, the resources as well. We certainly have the knowledge. So we are not in an easy situation. It's not that we can simply choose to ignore, ya Allah, the problems and hope it will just pass away. Because if we are the people with the solutions, if we are the people with the knowledge, and inshallah, people with the resources, then we are not only obliged to try and put forward the solution, but we are accountable to Allah. And that's what should worry us the most. Because if we don't try hard enough, Allah is going to ask us why we backslided, why we were lazy, why we sat around pretending as if we didn't have a role to play. We have roles to play, each in our own way and collectively. And it is our duty to get together and look at our situation. So it is not only a case of people are suffering blood, you know, bloodletting, turmoil, torture. It's a case of we are heading towards a destination which we don't know whether it's going to be paradise or hellfire. And as Muslims, at least, we needed to feel confident we had striven hard on the path to paradise. We have to ask ourselves, where are we going? But relief after difficulty is something which anyone can look forward to, because it will come. That's not the point. The point is, how well are we going to manage during the difficulties? All of life is ups and downs. All of life we have to face tests. Allah is going to test how well we are really truly following what we claim to be our deen. But in the end, we want to make sure, inshallah ta'ala, that with the knowledge and guidance Allah has given us, we performed well. We didn't just talk about it. We didn't feel good about having the knowledge. We performed. We functioned. We went out there and we acted. We weren't lazy. Now, some of the scholars in the old used to say that ordeals or trials, tribulations or misfortunes is a training of Allah. You know, with sweat and hard rigor and hardship, we become better people, better Muslims. So scholars in the past, they used to understand trials and tribulations are a way of Allah teaching us how to be more mature in Islam, how to be greater in faith. So they say it is training by Allah towards His creation. It is the education of Allah by which He opens the hearts, the hearings, the sights to become wiser. We can catch things up better now. We should be able to through hardship. Having suffered the hard way, we learn, being a Muslim, how not to make same mistakes twice, and how to watch out not to get caught unawares. In the Quran, of course, we have many, many ayat which gives us ample reason to feel secure that relief is always going to come around sooner or later. Only the people of disbelief or hypocrites, they lose hope. They are the ones who don't want to entertain any hope that Allah is going to take them out of their situation. But in the Quran we are told, فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرَ إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرَ. And scholars explained these ayat, just two of the ayat. So one of them, Al-Qasimi, Rahimahullah, he said that this shows, look at this way of Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the beginning, of course, the situation was very tight for him. The affairs were constrained, and he had put up a lot of trouble from his own people. He was known to be the kindest person around, most just, very eager to help and entertain guests, and always trying his very best to relieve the suffering of those who are undergoing problems. Yet when he came with the truth, his very own people who knew him to be the best person around, to torture him, mentally, physically, and his people. The very few people who accepted Islam in the first instance, they were hounded out, and they were banished, and they were starved, and they were beaten. All sorts of matters were constrained for him. He couldn't move around freely, he couldn't speak freely. And then of course we find when with the conquest of Mecca, in fact after the Hijrah, things began to look up. So relief came, and came in an astounding and stupendous way when he conquered Mecca. And thereafter, within a period of 23 years or less, or 25 years, we found so much of the world came under the light of Islam. And Islam opened all the doors and avenues to real freedom as equal worshippers before Allah. So the scholars have said, if you look at the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we can indeed draw inspiration and a good example of how relief follows hardship, and what is meant by hardship for a Muslim. Because no one can be better than Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then no one can be better than the companions. And they suffered a lot, all types of problems they had to encounter. Then the scholars explain that the word fa, in fa inna ma'a al-usri yusra, the fa indicates how the relief is directly connected to the problems. It has to come. Relief has to come because there is a problem. It must do. This is the way of Allah. And al-usr, the al is there to indicate that the problem is indeed something which is always going to bring about relief. So both of them are interconnected. And the ma'a shows the speed with which the relief comes. Now for an untrained person, a person of weak faith, he's going to get impatient. He will want that the relief comes right there and then. He can't wait even for 5 minutes. But for the trained person, the one who is rooted in faith, and he understands the truth beyond what meets the eye, he knows that the truth is much more sublime and meaningful than what people make it out to be in front of each other. He understands that he needs to just put up with the problems according to Iman. And when the relief does come, it is something which brings about a type of ease which nothing else can bring about. So in this respect, we have, for example, a statement from Umar radiallahu anhu. Because what happened was, during one of the battles, one of the companions, he wrote a letter to Umar radiallahu anhu. He was Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah radiallahu anhu. He was stationed at a distant outpost, and he saw a large number of Roman army gathering against the Muslims. They were being outnumbered. And some of the Muslims in the camp, they expressed the concern, and they said, you know, there was a lot of non-Muslims arming themselves and preparing themselves to attack us. We are very few in number. Maybe we ought to take some other types of precautions or change our strategy or something. So when he wrote back to Umar radiallahu anhu, he responded by saying, this is something which Allah sends down upon the believing slave to test them. Largeness of number, smallness of number, these are not the issue. The issue is, how well are we going to stand our ground and face up to the reality as a Muslim? Whatever is confronting us, that's the way Allah is testing us. We can't change the affairs, that's not in our control. And what we can do is to react to it according to knowledge and faith. So it is whatever Allah sends down upon the believing slave from the stations of severity. And this type of faith was carried by all the companions. One typical example is that of course, Abdul ibn Rawaha radiallahu anhu, when they were outnumbered 60-1. And again, the same type of concern went around the camp. So he said, men, what are you talking about? We don't fight them on account of our numbers, greatness of numbers, or, you know, strength of the army. We fight them on account of this religion, this deen of Islam, with which Allah honored us. So both prospects are fine, martyrdom or victory. And that's how a Muslim has to look at their situation. That what the Ummah is facing, globally speaking, all sorts of problems all around the world, they are trying to tear us apart and gobble us up or feed on us, like hungry wolves set upon a very tasty morsel in front of it. This is the way it's going to be. But how we are going to prepare and stand our ground and do what is required, whether lending a helping hand or raising some funds or doing dua or increasing in personal piety. Because if more and more of us become more honest in front of Allah, then less and less we are going to be undergoing trouble at the hands of those with whom Allah is displeased. So as one of the scholars said, Ishaq al-Ibad, he says, sometimes Allah tests the servants with trouble, with mihna, all types of hardship, and he saves him from destruction because of it. If we were left alone and just left to enjoy, and things were just fine all the time, we will become easygoing, we'll become lazy, and gradually we'll reduce our dedication to Allah. We'll become less sacrificing, we'll become more used to luxury, and we'll stop understanding why a Muslim needs to strive and spend from his own time, money, effort, and so forth. So sometimes Allah tests his servant with trouble, and he saves him from destruction by it. So the hardship becomes, as it were, a delayed blessing for him. So this is how we seek strength and understanding. We know Allah said in the Quran, he'll bring relief, and we also understand deeper than that indeed this test, these trials, tribulations, these are a way to avoid greater problems from us. These are a way for us to gather reward, inshallah ta'ala. As Ibn Kathir says, explaining that ayah, it is a promise, a wa'ada, that the relief will come. It's a promise on Allah the Most High. His promise is true, he will not break it. And the type of confidence we need to have, inshallah. We all say with our mouths, but in our hearts we should be able to feel the confidence. Allah will not break his promise. So what are the troubles we are going through? Contrast that with what is really happening to the Muslimun in general. There is an intellectual confrontation going on, well prepared. They're always trying their very best to twist the minds of people against Islam. Either they're mocking and making jokes out of it, laughing, making a laughing stock, or they're trying to really warp the understanding of Islam so that people cannot grasp the true meaning of it. Now, on the other hand, you have the physical oppression that's going on, where people choose to remain silent. And what really makes us upset, although we should be stable and grateful to Allah, with that still upsets us, is that Muslims are sometimes so quiet regarding their own problems. We don't moan, we don't complain. We have to know what they are and talk about it and do something, or do something towards the solution. And even more, what is so obvious is the silence from those who wield authority. They have power, some type of power. They manage resources, they run countries. They determine what should or should not be happening in a country, their policies and so forth. And they don't even raise one word of protest, even though it's a feeble cry of protest. Maybe they can't raise an army and send armaments and do things, but they can at least protest and say, we don't like it. We know we are being overpowered. At least be honest and say so. It will bring a lot of encouragement to the hearts of Muslims who know that they are not being abandoned. That there are people who care, but they are not being abandoned. But it's that the other people, they can't really help because their hands are tied. Say so. But we find those in authority, they don't even have that much courage or guts to say so. The honest truth, if that's the honest truth. And that makes us, leaves us wondering. There's a wonderful ayah in Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 259, which talks about how this person was going by the ruins of some kind of a village or hamlet. He says, "Oh, take the similitude of the one who passed by a hamlet." It's like a village, small buildings. "All in ruins to its roofs, dilapidated, run down." So he said, "How shall Allah bring it ever to life? And the yuhi hadihi, how will Allah make this come to life again, revive it? After its death, but Allah caused him to die for 100 years, then raised him up again." And then he said, "How long did you rest? Did you tarry?" So he said, "Perhaps a day or a short while, part of a day." And Allah said to him, "No, you have tarried thus 100 years. But look at your food and your drink. They show no sign of age." What is it? What is he being taught? Allah is teaching him how Allah can preserve something in spite of all the conditions being wrong. "They show no signs of age, and look at your donkey. And that we may make of you a sign unto the people, look further at the bones." The donkey had decayed, and it's just a mass of bones there, skeleton. "How we bring them together and clothe them with flesh." So he left the food and drink intact, it's still like edible, whereas the donkey had rotten and become just a skeleton, bunch of bones. And the man was made to sleep for 100 years. This is how Allah taught him that one should never lose hope. And we look at how, like in the Soviet, well, it's not anymore, it used to be until very recently, the Soviet Empire, or Soviet Russia, how Islam has been suppressed there, how it was like suppressed so brutally for so long. You know, people were being killed and mosques were done, turned into stables, nobody could even teach the Quran. It survived, and now one of the greatest world problems is how to stop the tide of Islamic fundamentalism in Soviet Russia. Isn't this a sign to us how Allah preserves the deen in spite of the great oppression? And China as well. A lot of problem in China now. The last 10-20 years there have been armed uprisings and killings and executions and so forth. Now look how brutally they have been suppressing. These two communist regimes have been suppressing Islam. So indeed, food and clothing is nothing compared to the deen itself, the iman itself. Allah still preserved it. And now their problem, the headache is how now to stem the tide of this growing Islamic fundamentalism, as they term it. We don't. They say fundamentalism. So when this was clearly shown to him, the man said, "I know that Allah has power over everything." That's the conclusion. And that's the conclusion we must always carry in our heads and hearts. Always. Allah has indeed power over everything. We have to do our duty. We have to stand firm and be a Muslim. And whatever we are talking about, the problems, they will pass, they will come and go. But in the end, victory belongs to Islam. So what I have here now is a number of ayat which Imam Hasan al-Basri mentioned. Imam Hasan al-Basri, he said, Alhamdulillah, It is surprising that the one afflicted by something, some kind of misfortune, overlooks five things. And he already knows what Allah has said about them, about misfortunes. What kinds of misfortunes can we suffer? Well, we can suffer something of loss of security. We can become afraid. You know, maybe our security is compromised. Maybe, you know, we feel so open to abuse. It could be that people are starving. We fear famine. We could suffer through famine, hunger. We could suffer through loss of goods. When the house gets burgled, or you know, like they do, they come to your country and they raise it to the ground, carpet bombing across with indiscriminately, like they have been doing in Chechnya. They don't care a bit. They wouldn't care. In fact, majority of the residents in Grozny were Soviet Russians, non-Muslim old Russian people in the basements and so forth. They don't even care for their own. The hatred of Islam and Muslims is so great, they don't mind sacrificing their own in order to kill one Muslim. That's how we have to understand the situation. So the ayah says, be sure, we shall test you with something of fear and hunger, some loss in goods or lives or the fruits of your toil. So five things are mentioned: fear, hunger, loss in property, the lives, people dying, and fruits of your toil, results. But give glad tidings, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. So give glad tidings to those who patiently persevere, the people of patience. That means those people who stick firmly to the knowledge Allah has given them in the Quran and Sunnah. They don't run amok, they don't become panicky. They know what to do. We are Muslims. We have guidance. If we don't know what to do, find out. If we know what to do, do it. We just stay firm, inshallah. Those are the persevering ones. So when they're afflicted with a calamity, they say, to Allah we belong, to Him is our return. It's not just a statement to say as a matter of etiquette. It's a realization from the heart that in the end, we are all going back to Him and we are going to stand trial. So how we behave is extremely important in order to pass that trial on the Day of Judgment. Simple as that. We are going to go back to Allah. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We're all going back to Him. We're going to do our very best now not to let the thief get away with what he's stealing. We're not going to let the criminal go away, abscond, you know, scot-free. We won't allow that to happen to the best of ability. But if we fail, we didn't succeed, we're all going back to Allah. Allah will then judge between the honest person and the dishonest person, the Muslim and the non-Muslim. The one who wanted to bring about fairness and justice and charity, and those who wanted to exploit the resources of people of the earth and suck it dry in the name of benefiting the poverty, the poor people. What hypocrisy you find in these conferences from the IMF and the World Bank that talk about alleviating poverty. That's why they have to give more and more loans. You just have to look behind this. What is going on? The whole, what we find, reason for poverty and enslavement of the masses is because of the usurious banking system. Yet on the other hand, you find the very same people that come and posture and talk about alleviating poverty. Just cancel all the interest-based debts, all of them, and see what happens. So to Him we belong, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. To Him is our return. It's not just a matter of saying something or an etiquette. It's a realization from the heart. We are in a struggle, we stick firm, we remain obedient, devoted, Muslim all, and we try our very best to thwart evil, to defeat what is wicked. And if we fail, no problem. In the end, we're all going back to Allah. We'll stand in front of Him. But if we hadn't tried, we just got messed around because we wanted to be messed around. Then of course, as the hadith says, each person will be raised up according to his intention. There are those Muslims who are neglecting their duties. And they're pretending as if everything is alright with some token gestures. By lip service, everything will just work out fine. And then when they're raised up, on the intentions Allah will judge. What is the intention? To be a Muslim? Bring about Islam on earth? Or to be part of the current cultural pattern, whatever is around you, to be part of that scenario by paying lip service to Islam? What is the intention? Another ayah Imam Hassan al-Basri quoted was from Al-Imran. He says, men said to them, a great army is gathering against you, so fear them. And that is the way of the disbelievers. Always they take pride and heart in their numbers. Always. They never have anything within themselves to feel strong or courageous. They're always looking for support from others around them. They don't depend on Allah. They don't have faith in Allah. So they can only seek strength from other people. Numbers. But a Muslim, even one Muslim against the whole world, he will have courage in his heart because it depends on Allah. Allah is determining the affairs. If the whole world were to rise up against that person, he can do nothing except what Allah wills it to happen. So how? So men said to them, a great army is gathering against you, so fear them. So our message to us is, inshallah, never be afraid or be feel hopeless or panicky that the whole world is now gathering to finish us off in so many different ways. Perhaps there is no light at the end of the tunnel, no silver lining. It's never like that. Never like that. It only increased the faith. And they said, for us, Allah is sufficient. وَقَالُوا حَزْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعَمَ الْوَكِيلُ. Enough is Allah for us as a disposer of affairs. Allah is controlling. Allah is testing. And that's how the Battle of Badr we find and the Battle of Hunayn. The two contrasting battles. Numbers mean nothing. We work for technology, we want to have the latest in science and so forth, but in the end, numbers mean nothing. The greatest scientific miracles can become rendered, you know, like dead wood floating on the sea. It only increased their faith. They'll say, for us, Allah is sufficient. He is the best disposer of affairs. And they returned with grace and bounty from Allah. They were successful. They had the upper hand. No harm ever touched them. And they followed the good pleasure of Allah. And Allah is the Lord of bounties unbounded. That's the second ayah. So many times these stories have happened in the past. In reality, prophets with their people fought against, largely, you know, outnumbering, number of enemies, and they came through. And we have this statement of Musa alayhi salam to Fir'aun, and he said, soon will you remember what I say to you now. Now you are mocking and passing over the truth as if it is dirt. And you don't want to dirty your clothes with your personality or your character with Islam. That's the kind of revulsion some people have, how they repel Islam, as if they don't want to be dirtied with it. They will dirty themselves with anything else. They'll read a book by Karl Marx or something. Read a book by some filthy guy. They read anything and everything. They will not touch the Quran. They will not read what Muhammad had to say, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So repelled. What are they running away from? So Musa alayhi salam said to Fir'aun, soon will you remember what I say to you. My own affair I commit to Allah. For Allah ever watches over his servants. Then Allah saved him from every ill that they plotted against him. But the brunt of the penalty encompassed on all sides the people of Fir'aun. They're the ones who were drowned in the sea. So we have stories even in that context, and how a nation is being convicted and being, you know, pushed into the sea as it were. Even then, they come out victorious, and the pursuing army is drowned in their very sight. Another ayah from Imam Hassan al-Basri. All that they said was, our Lord, forgive us our sins and anything we may have done that transgressed our duty. The typical reaction that should come about from a Muslim when he encounters a problem. These problems are perhaps because we haven't been doing well enough in the deen, Allah is punishing us. Or at least, is a way of Allah cleaning our sins. In either case, our realization should be of one of repentance. Repentful. So our Lord, forgive us our sins and anything we may have done that transgressed our duty. Establish our feet firmly. Make us stable upon the deen, the straight path. It's so easy to get budged off, nudged away, slowly, slowly. They whittle away. It's like, you know, when you're whittling away at a stick, trying to sharpen it with a blade or a knife. You whittle away. And that's how it works. It don't come and break you in half like that. It whittles away. You play with your sentiments, your emotions, your thinking ability, the way you look at things and understand things. And they have everything at their disposal. Entire education system and entertainment industry at their disposal. To whittle away at faith. Pair it off like skinning an apple. All that they said was, our Lord, forgive us our sins and anything we may have done that transgressed our duty, and establish our feet firmly. It's very important. And help us against those that resist faith. and I gained him a reward in this world and the excellent reward of the hereafter. Allah loves those who do good. So they're one in the end, in this world and the next. So these are four or five ayat which Imam Hassan al-Basri talked about, and we can relate to them at any time, wherever we live, at any society. We should be able to relate to it. For example, if you have heard some of these tapes or some of these books which talk about Freemasons and how they're trying to control the minds of people through entertainment and the sex industry and so forth, we'll understand how they affect faith. If we are not going to be so drastic as to say don't watch TV, that's fine. But then we ought to understand as mature people the downside of watching TV. What they're trying to do, manipulate our thinking and our tastes. What they're trying to grow in our hearts. Is it fondness for Allah? It's fondness for materialism. Or the most depraved type. What are they trying to grow in our hearts? Think about it. When I speak to you, either I'm just putting on a show, or inshallah I'm trying to be sincere, I'm trying to grow something in your hearts. Indeed. Whenever you talk to any friend, anybody, watch a program, listen to Radio 4, something has been done to your mind. You're allowing it. Ask yourself, what are you allowing to happen to you? Why are you listening to this? What do you think the effect is going to be? Or how do you think you're shielded from something when you know that something is openly wrong? For example, you go and watch a dirty film. You just indulge, one off, why not, other side friends, you know, don't be so strict, okay. So what do you think is the effect? Be very frank to yourself, be honest to yourself. They are trying all the time, and unless the Muslims, we ourselves, really come to grips with the deen, by knowing what Allah said, by knowing what the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we are going to be tossed around like, you know, anchorless, rudderless ship on a sea, wherever the waves take us. We have no handle on how to judge, what to filter out, what to retain. We have no handle. So Imam Hassan Basri said regarding these ayat, whoever sticks to reading these ayat during hardship, Allah will remove those hardships from him. Because reading these ayat, he will find courage, he will do what is right, he will repent to Allah, he will seek his help and carry on, get on with it. Because he promised and judged that was what will happen in these verses. The judgment of Allah is not rendered invalid and his promise is not broken. So let's look at this hadith which we have seen before. There's a different version from this concerning the same person, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet said to him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O young man, I will teach you some words. Preserve Allah, you will find him in front of you. Preserve Allah means do the duties. What is obligatory, carry out. What is prohibited, leave it. And try to come close to Allah by being as religiously, you know, functional as possible. Then he said, know him during ease. Remember Allah during your good times. He will know you during hardship. Know that whatever has slipped you was not going to touch you, was not going to reach you. And whatever has touched you was not going to reach you. So it wasn't going to slip you by. And know that help is with patience. And this is where the bit is different. Now the hadith says, this one is different because it says something new at the end of the hadith. It says, help is with patience. The help of Allah will come when we have stood our ground and did what was right according to Islam. Not if we cut corners and remain simple and increased in sinfulness. Then the help will not come. Know that help will come with patience. And relief is with sadness. And that with difficulty is ease. This is where he rounded it off, and this is the way we have to construct our lives, inshallah. That no matter whatever we are facing, in the end, if we don't remain constant in learning and practicing Islam, we are going to lose out in every sense of the word. Problem comes, we suffer, and we don't get nothing out of that suffering. Neither cleansing of sins nor rewards. It's just pure suffering and punishment. Instead of something to make us increase our rank in front of Allah, we become people who are simply punished. We don't know what is awaiting us in the next life. So every brother and sister, every Muslim who can think for himself, can distinguish between good and bad. Say 13, 14 years old and over, 13 and up, every one of us have our own individual duty to learn Islam the best we can. Read Quran and Hadith all the time, an explanation of that from the scholars, under every circumstances, because otherwise we are going to lose out. The Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was sitting with some of the companions, he said to them, shall I tell you, shall I not tell you something? So when distress or calamity affects a man from amongst yourselves, from the affairs of this world, doesn't he call upon his Lord? When a worldly problem affects any one of us, don't we call upon our Lord? Isn't that when we make religion sincere, become extra devoted, more dutiful? So they said, yes, indeed, we do call upon our Lord during times of trouble. So he said, indeed, Dhunnun, Jonah, Yunus alayhi salam, he prayed, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimeen. What this teaches us through the action of our Prophet, Yunus alayhi salam, and then taught by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is the great importance of realizing one's faults, one's own errors, his defects. It's very important. Most of us don't do that enough. That's why we can afford to be so arrogant and proud with each other, so over smart when it comes to Islam. We all have explanations, and we can give proofs to refute. We are never modest enough about our own faults, never humble enough to admit that we have severe problems with our own Islam, own defects. We never have that quality. And we find this, it's La ilaha illa ant. Realization when trouble happens, especially. There is no one worthy of worship except you. Subhanaka. Glory belongs to you. Perfection befits you and you only. Inni kuntu min al-zalimeen. I have been the one who is a wrongdoer. I am the one who was the oppressor. Indeed, I have been so. That realization is extremely important. Many of us are missing that. We shout hoarse our throats, vocally talking about our problems, and we should do this, we should do that. You know, what's the point of holding a demonstration where you put banners on your head saying jihad and shouting jihad, jihad, sitting in a field? What's that supposed to achieve? The best I can achieve is bad publicity for our Muslims, bad press. They're looking for this type of behavior so they can pounce on them and portray us as fanatics. That's what they want. You want to do jihad, just go and do it. Why you want to sit 1,000 miles away in a city and shout jihad? And the same mentality expresses itself in other ways. In England, you find this lamppost with jihad next to you. Do it. For the sake of Allah, do jihad if you have to do it. This comes about because of this. We don't want to admit our own faults. There is no modesty in front of Allah. No real humbleness in front of Allah. And we are suffering because of our sinfulness, we can say, to a large extent. As again, same person, Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah said, there is one type of good in which there is no evil, nothing. It's pure goodness in essence and in everything. The good in which there is no evil is gratitude with well-being. Gratitude to Allah. When Allah gave us enough rope to trespass, we trespassed. And that shouldn't have happened. When Allah gave us afiyah, you know, soundness, gave us relief or comfort, in that situation we should have been the best worshippers. But we let go of ourselves, we just indulged in fun and merrymaking. And then things began to go wrong. We began to miss prayers, and we began to lose the understanding of the kalima. And we incorporated shirk into our lives. And all sorts of malpractices in the name of culture and art and industry. And then we found ourselves, in the end, the disbelievers will never tolerate that Muslims identify with Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You can be a Muslim so long as you cannot identify with Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the bottom line. This sounds very harsh, but that's the bottom line. Think about it. You can be a Muslim and be anything you choose to be. But if you want to be a Muslim who wants to establish the law of Allah, and want to revive the Sunnah, there is a big problem. You can be as humble and as charitable as you like, you are a problem, a thorn by the side to say the least. The good in which there is no evil is gratitude with well-being, and patience during hardship. He said, how many people there are who are blessed, but they are not grateful? And so many people there are who are afflicted, but they are not being patient. They are losing their deen, honor of those people who are enjoying life, they're losing their deen as well, in both ways. Through suffering and through comfort, losing their deen over time. So why should Allah be happy with them and be pleased to help them? So knowing Allah during good times is very important. Ibn Rajab, one of the scholars, he explained, he said, the knowledge that we should have is not just knowledge of fiqh, and you know, these rules and regulations and things like that. He said, the aim of this knowledge, knowing Allah during good times, what is this knowing Allah during good times? He said, the aim of this knowledge is not general knowledge. It is a knowledge rather that enjoins the heart to favorably incline towards Allah and cast him off from the world. That's the type of knowledge we have to gain. It's not the knowledge that affirms the truth and faith. It is rather special knowledge that makes the heart to incline towards Allah. Those things that soften the heart, make us repentful and grateful and modest and soft and so on. And that which cuts him off from the world. We stop pursuing the pleasures of the world. What is legally we can benefit from, we do. But again, we can reduce our standards, inshallah, fun, having fun. That's the knowledge. That knowledge which makes him affable, you know, nice person, makes him tranquil, calm. He keeps his cool. He knows how to hold his ground as a Muslim without panicking. Tranquil in his remembrance of him, a dhikr, and makes him modest and fearful towards Allah. That's the knowledge. So what are we learning? I can go around now and pick up a book on fiqh and learn about, you know, the rules of wudu and rules of fasting and so forth. We have to know those things. And once I've learned that, is that it? So I know what makes fast and what breaks a fast? So I know. I can still walk around 10 feet tall and I'm only 5 feet 4. So it's like that. Knowledge that makes him modest and fearful of Allah. So what's that knowledge we're gaining? What have we learned in the last 1 week? What books have we read? What talks have we heard? What programs have we watched? What have we been speaking to each other about? Which made me, inshallah, grow a little bit more in this modest in front of Allah. What do we think? Or maybe a little bit more fearful of Allah. So as the ayah says in Surah As-Saffat, ayah 143, فَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ لَلَبِثَ فِي بَطْنِهِ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْيُبْعَثُونَ. Had it not been that he repented and glorified Allah, this is Jonah, alayhi salam. Had it not been that he repented and glorified Allah before he was swallowed by the fish. In good times, he was used to glorifying Allah, used to praising Allah, used to making his word the greatest, highest. He would have certainly remained inside the fish till the day of judgment, till the people are raised up, yub'athun, and they're all revived. He would have remained in that fish, in that condition, suffering, till the day of judgment. The only thing that saved him because he knew Allah during good times. And that's why the story is mentioned in the Quran, not just to fill a gap, to give us a lesson to the life of one of the greatest personalities, one of the prophets. So that ayah is very important. Had it not been that he repented and glorified Allah in good times, he would have remained inside the fish till the day of judgment. So if we think we are suffering, we are suffering a bit compared to what people are suffering around the world. We would like to think and we ask Allah that he's taking them as martyrs, inshallah. But we are not suffering. Let's not make believe ourselves to be suffering. When suffering comes, we will know. We have personal problems. We have difficulties at home. We have a job situation, perhaps. You know, we had a car accident, an insurance problem. You know, that's not suffering. Suffering is when you don't have enough to eat, and you say, when my cows die, my children die. There was a woman said in the news last night in Ethiopia. A Muslim woman, you can tell. Muslim names. And the man was reading the Quran. You know, and then the reporter is saying, oh, all he has left is to call upon his God, as if we couldn't see. That was a mockery of Islam in a subtle way. What can God do for these people? Is our Western relief agencies going to help? They showed a man reciting the Quran. And the woman said, when my cattle die, I know I'm going to die, my children are going to die. That is suffering. Last 5 minutes, we finish, inshallah. There were a number of pages here which talked about some of the things we can do to, inshallah, bring about relief in a quicker way, expedite the relief. I'll just mention one or two of these things which are easy for us to do, inshallah. This is easy. Sending the salat and salam upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is easy, and it brings tremendous benefit and affords us protection. It sounds sometimes superstitious, but it's not when we know what's happening behind the scene. What's happening when we say sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds. We know that because He informed us through His Prophet. Here's one hadith. The Messenger of Allah said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of those who come from my Lord came to me and said, there isn't anyone of the servants who sends salat upon you except that Allah sends salat upon him 10 times by it. So an angel came and spoke to him, giving this information from Allah, that there could be anyone, whoever he may be, he or she, if he sends this durood or salat wa salam upon you, Allah Himself sends 10 times more on account of that to that person, invoking peace, blessings, protection, praise, and so forth. So one of the companions, he said, O Messenger of Allah, what if I make half my prayer for you? I say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and so forth. He said, well, if you wish. It wasn't understood to be something too much. So then the man said, what if I make it 2/3? And again the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you wish. And again then the man said, what if I make all my prayers for you? Indeed, if I make all of my prayer for you. Then the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then Allah will suffice you from the sadness of this world and the hereafter. There's nothing superstitious about it. Allah is the agent. He is going to be doing these things. He will protect us. So he's going back to reliance upon Allah. But this sending salat upon the Rasul, what does that imply? That implies we are growing in our attachment to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So say these things from the heart, because we are more fond of him. We are more aware of his life. We are more aware of his sunnah. So we follow it. We study it more. More hadith we read, more times we mention the Prophet said, we end up saying sallallahu alaihi wasallam. With faith brings us benefit. Makes us people of the sunnah. It's not something to be sitting down all day long in a mosque corner and saying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, alayhi wa sallam. Not like that, of course. That's ridiculous. It shows how we attach ourselves to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the last thing, inshallah, is the forgiveness. We have to ask Allah for forgiveness. There are a lot of other things that dua was mentioned, maintaining good opinion about Allah was mentioned, many things, inshallah. But the last thing today is about repentance. Very short. As the Salaf used to say, some of the pious predecessors, they said, indeed this Qur'an directs you to both your diseases and your cures. This Qur'an directs you, shows you what are the illnesses you can suffer from and the cures if you do fall into those illnesses. As for your diseases, it shows you the sins. Those are the diseases, the sins, sinfulness. Think of the sins that we commit. Not major ones, inshallah we are protected from the major ones, inshallah ta'ala. But anyway, even then, think of the sins. Like being disrespectful to your elders. That's sinful. Dishonoring a Muslim, disreputing a Muslim. Sinful. Some of them are major again. So think of them. So as for your diseases, it shows the sins. As for your cures, then seeking of His forgiveness. That's what the Quran teaches us. So seeking forgiveness, what happens? We become aware of ourselves, our own faults, our own defects. That's what I emphasize today. We need to look more at ourselves. What are our own defects, shortcomings, our own deficiencies? So when we do that, we repent, what happens? As the Quran says, saying, ask forgiveness from your Lord, for He's all forgiving. He will send down, يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا. He will send down to you rain in abundance. So the weather will work out in our favor. Climate will change. وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ. And He will support you, increase you in your children. Family will prosper. Wealth and sons. And bestow upon you. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ. And bestow upon you gardens. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارٍ. And He will send upon anhara and send upon you, give you rivers, flowing rivers. So you can see a lot of physical change will take place. When we are repentful, we seek forgiveness properly. we amend our lives, we become true Muslims, inshallah, we have the promise in the Quran. You can take it or leave it. Of course, it's a test for us now. I can just read this and say, nah, I don't think so, and just walk away. Or I can say, no, I'm going to give it a go. I'm going to try and be a good Muslim at least. If not the ummah, the family, or my neighborhood, myself, I will win, inshallah, with Allah's mercy. I will have prosperity, inshallah. I will have wealth and children, and I will have, inshallah, enough food to eat, inshallah. That's how he's going to gain confidence as a Muslim. So ask forgiveness from your Lord. He is oft forgiving. He will send down rain to you in abundance and give you increase in wealth and sons and bestow on you gardens and bestow on you rivers of flowing water. Brothers and sisters, one thing you notice now, we talk about the population problem. We talk about starvation at the world scale unless we do something about birth control and so forth. Who do you think Allah is blessing even now in spite of all the problems in terms of birth rate? What do you think is the population scenario of Europe in the next 20 years, next 50 years? Germany has recently given the green card to Indian workers, saying they need about 80,000 workers. If they want to work for long term, automatically they'll naturalize German citizens from India. In this kind of situation, America is looking for about, I think, 350,000 IT staff. This is not just statistics for technology and programming and work. It has another underlying meaning of what's happening to the population, the aging European population. So they have prosperity. What do you think, prosperity? Where is the wealth and sons and daughters and children? Who will inherit the earth, do you think, inshallah, in the end? Allah has preserved Islam already in China, in Russia and so forth. So there is torture, there is problem. We are going to have even more worse situation heaped on us. But the future looks really bright in the end. If we stick to faith, we are the winners, no doubt. So be inshallah sensible, be inshallah alert, and don't be swamped by all this mad talk from people trying to scare us off, saying a large army is gathering against you. That should increase our faith, inshallah. May Allah guide me and guide you. Unite us upon the truth. Forgive our sins. Help us to practice the faith. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant our Jannah fulfilled to all the Muslims, past, present, and future. Ameen. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta.